Welcome to my first lecture on discrete time Fourier transform. In this video, we will try to discuss the frequency concept of discrete time signals and more accurately for sequences. Now, this DTFT, that is discrete time Fourier transform, actually it provides the spectrum of discrete sequences. Okay, now if we consider xn, so this is your sequence, right? Now for this sequence, if you use DTFT, discrete time Fourier transform, then you will get its frequency content that will express in this form. The capital X will be used to indicate the frequency domain, and here we will consider in this form it will be part j omega, where omega is called digital frequency, okay, in contrast to the angular frequency, angular digital, this is digital angular frequency, okay. And we know that capital omega will be used for analog frequency or angular frequency rather. Okay, so this frequency of small omega is a little bit different from this capital omega. Okay, that we will discuss a little bit later. Now, first of all, let me explain the relation between these two. Okay. So this capital X of omega, we can obtain capital X of e to the power j omega. It is written as, this is simple summation of this xn times e to the power minus j omega n. Okay, and n we can vary from minus infinity to infinity. Okay, so this is sequence xn. Generally we are considering the finite length sequence xn, so in that case you can take appropriate limit, right? So this is your frequency domain expression of a sample domain x of n. So this is your samples, remember. These are not actually the time domain signal, some samples only right now. Now we can get back xn, and xn we can get back by taking this one. This is 1 upon 2 pi and it's integral. This capital X of e to the power j omega, it's times this e to the power j omega n, and so integrate with respect to omega. Okay, and this integration is only for 2 pi, a period of 2 pi. So you can start from minus pi to plus pi or 0 to 2 pi, any range. Okay. So actually we saw that this x of e to the power j omega, this one is basically a periodic signal with periodicity of 2 pi. So every 2 pi it will repeat itself. So that's how this signal, if you integrate with only one range of 2 pi, that will give you the xn. So that is one difference from standard or analog Fourier transform concept or continuous time domain Fourier time concept. Okay, so we'll try to explore this thing in detail in this video. So from where we are getting these lessons and how it is useful to get the exact frequency content of a signal, discrete time signal. Remember that this small omega is not an exact frequency, analog frequency. So there should be some mapping between this small omega and this capital omega. So that will also we'll discuss in this lecture. Okay, so to get this reason or this idea, we'll start from our basic concepts for the continuous time signal. Okay, so for continuous time signal, so for this continuous time domain signal, we have discussed the Fourier transform and Fourier series in detail in my previous lectures, so you may go through. Okay, so in this video we will try to discuss very briefly. Okay, so if you face any difficulty, then I'll suggest you to go through those lectures again. Okay, now first of all I'll consider that xt is a signal and which is continuous and periodic. So this is a periodic signal. Okay, with time period t naught. Okay, so its fundamental frequency, angular frequency is omega naught, is 2 pi over t naught. And that, so t naught, its unit is in second, and whereas this omega naught, sorry, so here onwards we will consider one thing, we will denote capital omega naught. Okay, so capital omega will be used to indicate the continuous or analog frequency, right, angular frequency. So this unit is radian per second, right. Now for this signal, as it is periodic, we can use Fourier series. So using Fourier series concept, we can find the frequency content of xt signal, right? And using this series, we can expand this xt in terms of, we can express in terms of the exponential periodic signals, summation of exponential periodic signals, okay? The summation of the cn times e to the power j in this omega naught times t, right, and where n could be from minus infinity to infinity, but n is an integer, that is not put down, n is integer, right. So this cn we can compute, and cn is given by is 1 upon t naught, an integration this x of t, and you multiply with e to the power minus j n omega naught t. Right? And this limit we'll consider for this one time period t naught. That you may consider 0 to t naught or minus t naught by 2 to plus t naught by 2, same thing. Okay, so for simplicity I am considering minus t naught by 2 to plus t naught by 2, right? So this you can compute the cns. Okay, so what is the meaning? That you will get these values. So c0 you can get, c1, c2, c3, up to all those things, all positive side as well as negative n is also possible. Okay, so I'll consider c minus 1, c minus 2, c minus 3, like that. So these are the coefficients for different n, no? So but actually these are related to, so you see the n omega naught frequency. So this c naught is actually amplitude of a DC frequency, okay, DC signal. So that I will call it DC or zero frequency. Okay, so this is DC level c naught, and next one is the frequency of omega naught, and next one is 2 omega naught, then 3 omega naught, like that. And this side is minus omega naught, minus 2 omega naught, minus 3 omega naught, like this. So these are the corresponding amplitudes in this frequency. So these are the exponential signals, e to the power j omega naught t, e to the power j 2 omega naught t, like that, those exponential signals, and these are the corresponding amplitudes. So if you sum it up, you will get x of n. Okay, so here you will see this xn will contain zero frequency omega naught, 2 omega naught, 3 omega naught, in general this n omega naught. So integer multiple of omega naught imply that it will contain the frequencies integer multiple of omega naught. So obviously omega naught is particular one value, that is nothing but, so capital omega naught, sorry, this is 2 pi upon t naught. So here we can say that the spectrum is discrete. Okay, that is the important conclusion here. So using Fourier series, we will get the spectrum of a continuous xt periodic signal, and its spectrum is discrete. It will contain only the frequencies integer multiple of omega naught, no other frequencies, right? Okay, then we'll go for the second one, that is xt the aperiodic signal. Okay, now for periodic signal we can understand certain frequency, at least the fundamental frequency we can understand, because t naught, after every t naught it will repeat. So 1 upon t naught is the fundamental linear frequency, that is in hertz, and 2 pi upon t naught is the angular frequency, that is called radian per second. But here it will not repeat. So how to get the frequency concept of this aperiodic signal? Okay, so for that you see we started with again making this aperiodic signal first of all as a periodic signal with certain period t naught, and then we'll make this t naught as large as possible, and it will become infinity. When it will become infinity, then actually the signal is becoming aperiodic. Means just see, if I consider this is one a time limited signal, so this is your time limited up to t, this is a small t, so this is your aperiodic signal x of t. Now I can get a periodic version of this one if I consider that this signal will repeat after capital t naught time. Okay. If I think that the same shape, so this is your t 0 to t. Now suppose this is your t naught. After that, it will again repeat itself. So similarly, it can repeat again at 2 t naught. Okay. So then this signal is obviously a periodic signal. You can call it xpt. A periodic version of this aperiodic signal. Okay. So for this periodic signal, first we can find the Fourier series. We can find Cn, right? And then from that we'll get this. So this xpt we can express in this form: the summation of Cn times e to the power j n omega naught t, and n is minus infinity to infinity. Now xt, this xt will become same as, or xpt is that it is same as equivalent to xpt when t naught is approaching to infinity. No, that means that periodic signal will repeat after infinite time. So this is as good as a periodic signal. Okay, it is not repeating at all, right? But if I consider this t naught as infinity, so if you see in this case, as t naught is infinity, then the omega naught approach, that is equal to 1 up 2 pi upon t naught, obviously it is approach to 0, right? So the fundamental frequency is very close to origin, and this n integer 1, if he considers every integers, then your next sample will be very close to that previous sample. So you will get a continuous spectrum. So omega naught 2, omega naught 3, omega naught, if you place one after another, and if all are very close, you will get a continuous spectrum. Okay, so in that case, this n omega naught is replaced. Sorry, again, we are considering this thing, this capital omega naught. Be careful. So this is again, this is the capital. So n capital omega naught, that will consider as a continuous domain omega, capital omega. Okay, and then what you will get? So this x of j omega, in this case that we have discussed earlier, please go through my previous lectures, you will see that this capital x of j omega, it is given by, that we have got it, no? That integration of x of t and e to the power minus j capital omega t. Okay, that is your dt. So this third range we'll consider minus infinity to infinity. Right. So, but be careful here. So this spectrum is not giving you exact Cn value. Rather, so you will see that the Cn is 1 upon t naught. So you see that Cn is 1 upon t naught times, no, that integration of this xpt and e to the power minus j n omega naught t and dt. So this is for one time period. So suppose minus t naught by 2 to plus t naught by 2. And you see here, as t naught is approaching infinity, so this limit will become minus infinity plus infinity. So this xpt is same as xt, and this n omega naught will replace by capital omega. Okay, so you will get this expression. But you see here, we are ignoring this term. That is one important thing. We are not considering 1 upon t naught, because if you consider 1 upon t naught with this integral, then cn value will become close to 0 every time, because t naught is approaching infinity. Okay, so that type of spectrum is useless, where every value is close to 0. We can handle it. Okay, so rather, excluding this 1 upon t naught, the rest one, if you consider, that will give you some relative frequencies. Okay, though it is not exact, but it, you will get some spec, some relative frequencies, some pattern you will get, and that will work for us. But in inverse Fourier transform, there we'll take some measurement to include this t naught, whatever we have done here, so that we'll get xt from this spectrum only. Okay, and that is also very simple. It is given by xt, we can get back. So from this capital X of j omega, capital omega, first we should multiply it with j capital omega t and integrate it d omega, and we can show that if this scale factor 1 upon 2 pi, it is sufficient. It is exactly same thing, so you will get x of t, and limit you should consider minus infinity to plus infinity, right? So this is about aperiodic continuous time domain signal. Okay, now we'll move to the discrete signals and sequences. Now for sequence, so we understand that xn is a sequence. Okay, so its index is integers, then is n could be 0, 1, or it could be negative, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, all those things, all integers. Right? So here there is no concept of time here in this case. But how to get this sequence from our real valued time domain signal? Okay, that we should understand first. So if we consider xt is a continuous time domain signal, okay, then if we take samples at regular interval, and that interval is ts, suppose, so you are taking the samples at n ts. Okay, every ts, ts, 2ts, 3ts, n ts. Okay, we are taking all the samples, and that instant only we will get. Okay, and that value will be the time x of n ts. Right? So these are the samples. But the samples are located at t equals to nts, right? But now if I discard this time index, this time reference ts, if we work with only the index small n, so here, from here onward, if we consider this x of n, that sample values, these are the sample values, or samples, and here we will call it, this is the discrete time signals. So here ts is associated, so here there is no concept of ts, so we are working with only the samples. So how fast it is coming, or how fast it is sampling is done, suppose if it is not taken care, then those samples are here only, it is x of n, right? So for example, if we consider this is our signal over t, then this is your x of t, and x of t is is t again. So you see this one, then we are taking samples at regular interval. So if t equals to nts, there is the discrete samples. But again, same thing, if we consider here, and if I say these are the samples n, then just I will work with these sample values. So no need. So this is suppose 0, this is suppose 1, this is suppose 2, this is suppose 3, this was 4, like that. So first 0 value was 0, and first at 1, okay, t equals to ts, this is the height, so that I can take here. Then this is the height, then this is the height, okay, then suppose this is the height, like this. So those things I can consider only. This is the x axis is n, so this will give you x of n, and here it is, these are x of nts. So I think you have got the point. So what is the difference between discrete time signal and the samples only? Okay, now if you work with the samples only, then if you try to find out the spectrum, its frequency content, will you get exact frequency? Okay, is it possible? Okay, now suppose these samples are coming quickly, okay, then how it look like? It will look like this one. Like this. This is your n. So samples are coming quickly, and if samples are coming slowly, okay, so there I'll consider it is a t time. The samples, okay, the ts I'll consider is small, so ts is small enough. And now ts is large, so you see this one, and then that what we have considered here, this one, and then this one, then this one, then this one, this one, okay. So here ts is large. So obviously, just looking at this figure, you'll see this signal, their magnitudes are changing rapidly over time. So obviously this signal should have higher frequency content. So its frequency, we can understand that it should be high. It should contain high frequency. Whereas this one, you see, it is changing slowly, right? So it is a low frequency signal. So what I want to mean here, that along with the samples, the TS is important. So unless TS is provided, you can't get exact frequency. If you consider TS a little bit larger, then the same sample will give you high frequency content. And if you consider TS low, then same samples will give you low frequency signals. Okay? So that we'll discuss in detail in the subsequent part. Let us see. Now we'll consider the samples only. We'll start with samples, then we'll come back to discrete time signal. We'll try to introduce the TS, right? Now this is the periodic. I'll start with sequences. के सैंपल्स और सीक्वेंसेस। सपोज दिस इज योर एपरियोडिक सीक्वेंस, सॉरी एट जीरो इट इज जीरो, दिस वन देन दिस वन देन दिस वन देन दिस वन दिस वन देन दिस वन, ओके एंड देन इट इज दिस इज योर इंडेक्स एन, दिस इज जीरो। सो आई कंसीडर दैट दिस एपरियोडिक सीक्वेंस is of finite length. Okay, and that length is suppose capital N1 plus 1, suppose that I am considering. So suppose this one is your capital N1, 0 to N1 it is non-zero, and beyond that all are zeros. Clear? Okay. Now, this sequence xn, so this is called as xn. We wish to find out its spectrum, its frequency content. So again, we will take the same strategy. We will try to make a periodic sequence from this one. Then we will try to use the Fourier series concept, but in this case, it is discrete time Fourier series. Okay, that we'll try to use. So, what I'll do? So from here, we'll consider a periodic sequence. So you see, the same safe. So this is your safe. Then zeros. So after a certain time, n, from n again, it will repeat. Then zeros, okay? Again at 2n, again it will repeat. Okay, similarly left side as well, it can have something here, left side as well, so it's a periodic. So that we can consider as xp of n, periodic version of xn, and the shape is repeated, so n is a period of the sample, so after n sample it will repeat, means xp of n plus minus kn, k is integer, again you will get xp of n, right? Okay. Now here this fundamental frequency here, so that we'll consider small omega naught. So small omega naught will define as this 2 pi upon capital N. So similar to the analog domain, no? So in analog, you understand that for XT, so I'll consider a different color. This X of T, this is the signal, continuous domain signal, and T naught is the time period. Then capital omega naught was 2 pi upon T naught. So this is T naught is second, and this is your radian per second. Okay, so this is your 2 pi only, radian. And A is N is integer. So this is, nothing is there. Earlier, 2 pi was radian and T naught is in seconds. That's how unit was radian per second. In this case, its unit is only radian. So be careful. And it is called as digital frequency, in contrast to, so this is called digital fundamental frequency. Okay. Fundamental angular frequency, rather. Okay. Now we'll work with this one. So as xpn is periodic, now we can use the Fourier series concept. Okay, but in this time, discrete time. Fourier series. That we can use this concept. So using that concept, similar to this one in analog domain, you see the analog domain first. So this xn is considered as, so xt was considered as the cn times e to the power j n omega naught, capital omega naught t. Okay, the same thing we'll do here. So here what we'll do, this xpn we'll consider as the summation of cn times digital frequencies, okay, discrete periodic signals. Okay, so discrete means e to the power, earlier e to the power j n omega naught t, and in this case it is, so as we have taken n here, so better to consider here another index, it is k, we'll call it ck, and e to the power j k omega naught t, not t, omega naught n, is right. So in this n the time, this is sample index, and here the k is the index for this c value, amplitude of this or coefficient of this periodic signals, it is amplitude of the signals, periodic signals. Okay, so k could be, this k is minus infinity to infinity, right? So now ck we can find out. Okay, so what is your ck? So you see the c sub k that we can compute. So try to understand, try to compare with analog, a continuous domain. Okay, xt was the continuous domain signal. Okay, and for that we are considering that xt equals to summation of cn e to the power j n omega naught capital omega naught t, and here n equal to minus infinity plus infinity, and where cn was given by 1 upon t naught and integration x of t e to the power minus j n capital omega naught t. Okay, it's dt. So comparing with this one, what is ck? Ck would be similar. So t naught was the time period. Here it is a, this one is 1 upon n, capital N. Is right? And now here we are working with sequences. So integration should be replaced by summation. Okay, so xt is replaced by x of samples, x of n. And this e to the power minus j n omega naught t, this continuous domain periodic signals should be replaced by discrete time periodic signals, okay, or discrete domain. Okay, so e to the power minus j n small omega naught, or rather we'll consider this one is k, so this is, be careful here. So we are considering ck, so this is your k, so e to the power minus jk omega naught, and then small n. So n is the index for these samples. N is from minus infinity to plus infinity, and k is the index for the ck value. Okay, the amplitude of these coefficients. Okay, Fourier coefficients. Right. Now here you see again. I have started with x of n. It's time limited, a finite length sequence. Okay, so that we can consider here. So this, it is 1 upon n, it is fine. Now this summation, now for that one, we can consider that it was started from 0 and up to n 1, right? Now beyond that, xn is 0. So okay, so this is your xpn. Or here we will consider xn on, right? Fine. So what will be happening here? What will happen here? So n equal to 0 to n 1. This is the things, and this is your x of n, and this one will remain e to the power minus j k omega naught and n. So what is the idea? Idea is that I want to get the frequency content of a priority signal. Okay, that means I have to make n approaching to infinity, no? So if n is approaching to infinity, then the sequence will become almost aperiodic, because it will repeat after infinite time. Okay, that is the concept. So for that, we want to get the ck values, then we want to see what is the frequency content. Same as earlier, very similar to the continuous time domain periodic, sorry, aperiodic signals, right? So n is approaching to infinity. As n is approaching to infinity, you will see 1 upon n is approaching to 0, right? However, this term is independent of, this is your independent of capital N. That is interesting. So if you work with this thing only, then also we will get a function of k, okay, excluding this 1 upon n, because every ck will have some amplification factor of capital N, then we will get something, okay. Otherwise, if you include this capital N here, so if you include this capital N here, then 1 upon n, it will become 0. So every ck will become 0. So that is not meaningful for us. So, but this one, this in summation will give you certain idea about the ck safe of the ck. So that will work with that one, okay? So here, what is happening? As n is approaching to infinity, this omega naught, which is 2 pi upon capital N, it is also approaching to 0. Okay, so this k omega naught, they are very close to each other. So the adjacent samples are very close to each other. Okay, so we can say that the ck, if you collect all the ck values, that will give you almost the continuous pattern. Okay, so what we'll do, we'll replace this k times omega naught by a continuous variable, that is your small omega. Okay, so what is happening here? If I consider this thing, then this integral, okay, so this integral part, the summation part, that will become So what is happening? The summation x of n, this is e to the power minus j small omega only, and it is n, right? And if I call this is your capital X of the function of omega, so we write in this form e to the power j omega. Okay, we can write capital X of only omega or capital X of j omega anyway. So, but basically it is a function of small omega, right? But this is popular convention we are considering for DTFT case. Okay, and it is a certain logic to consider it for j omega, that will be discussed later. So that will come from Z transform idea. Okay, anyway, so this x of n, so here this integral n equal to 0 to n 1. So you see this function is totally independent of capital N. Okay, and here we have considered a continuous variable small w. Then you see this ck is basically, it is 1 upon n, and this x of j omega, e to the power j omega, this function here, now you need to take samples at omega equals to k omega naught, right? You will get exact value for ck. Now as k tends to infinity, so ck is going to 0 for every k, so we are not going to use it. The actual amplitude of this coefficients, okay, Fourier coefficient, rather will work with this thing only, and that is considered as discrete time Fourier transform, right? So discrete time Fourier transform for this xn, its DTFT is capital X of e to the power j omega, and which is basically summation of x of n and multiplied by e to the power minus j omega n. And so it, if the range depends on the length of this xn, the range of this xn. Okay, so if you don't know, then we can consider entire range. N we will consider minus infinity to plus infinity, right? So this is your DTFT. Now it's interesting to find out the inverse DTFT. Now from this spectrum, now we have to get back this xn. Okay, now we'll try to get the inverse DTFT. So meaning is that from a capital X of e to the power j omega, we wish to get X of n. Okay, so now see this one, this integral. Okay, I'll consider this integral 1 upon 2 pi this capital X of e to the power j omega, this function, and it is multiplied with e to the power j omega n plus e to the plus j omega n. Okay, here it was minus, and then multiply d omega and integrate it, and integrate over 2 pi range only. Okay, it could be from minus pi to plus pi, 0 to 2 pi, any range, a range of 2 pi. Okay, so we used to compute right now this integral. What is this? Right, so how to get that one? So this is same as 1 upon 2 pi. Now I replace this x of t part j omega by this one. Okay, so that we use different colors. Suppose this one. So this is summation x of n. So here already we have taken n, no? So we should take another variable. We should consider suppose m. Okay. So x of m and this is e to the power minus j omega m, right? Where m is a dummy variable, integer variable, so that will vary from minus infinity to infinity. So this is your capital X of e to the power j omega, right? If you take the summation, you will get a function of omega, that is your capital X of e to the power j omega. Now we'll multiply this with this one. This e to the power j omega n, and then multiply d omega, and this omega range is okay. Any range we can take is minus pi or 2 pi. It's a range of 2 pi. That's all. Okay. Now, what we'll do? So you see here, this omega is here as well, and here. Fine. So can I take this integration first? Then we'll take summation later with respect to m. Okay. Can I do that one? So this 1 upon 2 pi is outside, okay. And this integral or 1 upon 2 pi also we can include there. That's better. Okay. So this summation I will take, and it is with respect to x of m will be outside. This is m range is minus infinity to plus infinity. Right? Now I'll put this integral. Okay. So that one I'll consider for here. This is 1 upon 2 pi and this integral of 2 pi. Now I'll combine these two together. Okay. So if I combine these two together, then what you'll get? E to the power, this is j omega, and it is n minus m. No. And this is your d omega. This integral you will compute, and then whatever you will get, with that you will multiply x of n and then take summation. Because this integral, after taking this integral, it is a function of m. No? So this is a function of m, and this is also a function of m. Then you will multiply these two together and then you will take summation. Right? Okay. Now, here we will consider one more thing. That now I'll take two cases, when m equal to exactly n and when m not equal to n. Okay, so when m equal to n, then what you will get? So I'll get only x of particular one sample, m equal to n, that is your x of n, right? Or you can write in this color. This is your x of n, right? And multiplied by that term. What is the term? It is 1 upon 2 pi. This integral over 2 pi. And I have considered m equal to n. No? Then if I consider m equal to n, the n minus m equals to 0. So e to the power 0, and e to the power 0 means, okay, I'll write e to the power 0. So you'll get e to the power 0 and d omega. I think it is correct. Okay, and then the rest one means when m not equal to n, so total summation we'll consider. So this summation x of m, again I repeat, and this one 1 upon 2 pi, the integral of 2 pi e to the power j omega n minus m and d omega. Okay, and here m again minus infinity, but except m not equal to n. Is it correct? So we'll try to compute these two separately. Right. Now, what is the first term? Let us see. So first term is this one. Okay. I think you can get this. So this term, I'll show that it will vanish. It will become zero for every m. Okay, and this one, this integral, you see. So this is that you should remember omega. Okay. So that integral is equals to x of n, and this one was 1 upon 2 pi, and e to the power 0 is 1, and it is d omega, 1 times d omega and over 2 pi. Okay, plus that one, that term. So that term will compute separately, and I'll show you that this term is 0. If it is 0, then you'll see this is, this one is x of n, and this is your x of n times 1 upon 2 pi, and this integral is omega, and omega for 2 pi is 2 pi, so it is 2 pi, cancel out, so you will get xn. Now see the logic, why the second term is absent. Okay, so what is the second term? The second term was this summation x of m and integral 1 upon 2 pi was there, it is fine, and integration of 2 pi, and this is e to the power minus or plus j omega n minus m and d omega, right? So here m is minus infinity to infinity except m equals to n. Okay. Now, what is this one, this integration? Right? If we work with this integration, integration over 2 pi e to the power j omega, and this is n minus m, and you see that n minus m, they are not same. So you will get another integer. Okay, that integer, suppose if it is any other integers, so I can say it's p, small p. Okay, and it is d omega. So if you integrate this one, so e to the power j omega is a periodic function. So this is also a periodic function. And this is a periodic function of 2 pi. So e to the power j omega p obviously is a periodic function of 2 pi. Okay. And if you integrate this one, so e to the power j theta is cos theta plus j sin theta. So what 2 pi, it is periodic. So cos theta and sin theta both will become 0. So triangle will become 0. In that way also you can prove, otherwise also you can prove it. So e to the power, what is the integration? E to the power j omega small p, integration is j small p. Okay, and now I'll take one range, suppose any range 0 to 2 pi. So this is your speed, right? So what is this? E to the power j, so omega is 2 pi, so it is 2 pi small p minus e to the power 0 is 1 upon kp. So e to the power this one, e to the power j 2 pi, it is simply cos 2 pi plus j sin 2 pi, and cos 2 pi is 1 and j sin 2 pi is 0, so that is 0 j into 0, so it is 1. Okay, so e to the power j 2 pi is 1, so e to the power j 2 pi times small p, p is integer, remember p is integer, thus e to the power j 2 pi to the power p, we can consider it's integer, so this is 1 to the power p, it is always 1. Okay, so this is also 1, so it is 1 minus 1 by upon jp, and that will become 0. Right, so this part is becoming 0. So if this is becoming 0, so total summation will become 0. Right, for every m. Every m, this integral is becoming 0, thus the summation is also becoming 0. Okay, thus I have considered it is 0. So you will get x of n. Okay, so means that integral will give you your exact sequence x of n. Means this is your inverse DTFT. Right, so inverse DTFT is given by, so total, okay, I want to write xn is DTFT is capital X of e to the power j omega, right, where this capital X, this forward one DTFT e to the power j omega is computed as summation x of n e to the power minus j omega n. N is minus infinity to infinity. And this x of n is 1 upon 2 pi, an integral over 2 pi, right? This capital X of e to the power j omega times e to the power j omega n, integrate with respect to omega. So this is your DTFT. So here this omega is the digital frequency that we have said, right? Now we can discuss the, what is the relation between this digital frequency omega is called digital angular frequency. And its unit is in radian only, not radian per second. So what is the relation between capital omega? So I'll try to give you some justification for that. Now, if we consider xt is a time continuous time domain, so okay, continuous time domain aperiodic signal, okay, so for that we have got this Fourier transform, continuous time domain Fourier transform, so capital X of j capital omega we have considered, and that is given by integration x of t e to the power minus j capital omega t and dt, range is minus infinity to infinity. Now here if you take samples, okay, This is of continuous time. Now you are taking samples at regular interval, and t is replacing by nts. Then what is happening? Okay, this function, try to understand. So x of t, what is happening x of t? So you see the x of t is changing to x of nts, right? You are taking samples at regular interval only. And now if I remove this time ts, if we work with the samples values only, that will consider as simply x of n, right? Now this omega, it is, so what is happening, it is called j omega t. Okay, this analog periodic signal, so e to the power minus j capital omega t, if you take sample at nts. So what is happening, e to the power minus j capital omega, and this is your nts. So that we can consider as e to the power minus j n times capital omega, or sorry, this is omega times ts into n. We can write it this way. So this omega and ts I can club together, then it is n. So I can write this thing as e to the power minus j small omega, we'll take one another variable n, and where small omega is basically capital omega times ts, right? So if I take this replacement, right, then what is happening here in the right side? So right side is becoming samples, okay? X of t is replaced by x of n, and this one replaced by x of n, okay, and this is replacing by e to the power minus j omega n, okay, but samples only. So this integration will become a summation, right? So can I take this thing as summation? Integration is replaced by summation, and x of t is replaced by x of n, and e to the power minus j omega t is replaced by e to the power minus j small omega n. So this will give you a function of small omega, okay? So that is a different function that again will write capital X of e to the power j omega. So there is a close relation. So here n is minus infinity to plus infinity. So we can get this relation from here. Fine. If we consider that we are taking samples at ts interval, then we are throwing out the ts values. We are working with the samples only. But here, the displacement to small omega is becoming capital omega times ts. Okay. So this is a relation between continuous domain frequency with the digital frequency. Okay. Or in other words, this capital omega we can calculate as small omega upon ts, and 1 upon ts is fs, so omega times f into s, fs, f suffix s. So where fs is the sampling frequency in hertz and omega is the radian, simply radian, then if you multiply these two, you will get radian per second. Okay, so means every digital frequency you have to multiply with fs, then you will get corresponding analog frequency. Okay, so we'll discuss this thing in detail later again, okay, in the subsequent lecture. Please follow the next video, and if you enjoy this video, please subscribe my channel in order to get my future videos. Thank you.